Your HRV is unique to you. While it's true that higher HRVs are generally considered to be healthier because they reflect a kind of autonomic flexibility, lots of factors can have a big impact on your HRV. This means that what constitutes a high or low HRV can vary significantly. When it comes to interpreting HRV then, more important than absolute values are changes and trends over time. As a brief recap, HRV typically decreases as the heart beats more rhythmically, reflecting an acute stress response and sympathetic nervous system activation. But over time, regular exercise tends to increase HRV at rest, and this is indicative of a healthy, resilient heart and a well-balanced autonomic nervous system. The takeaway when it comes to interpretation is that HRV can't be boiled down to absolute rules. After intense training blocks, for example, an overactive parasympathetic nervous system response might elevate your HRV. You could interpret this as a positive sign of having achieved a balance between your sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous systems, indicating an appropriate training response. But it could also suggest a need for recovery if the parasympathetic nervous system is working overtime to counteract stress. In other words, you might interpret your high HRV as meaning that you are well rested, when in actuality, it's high because your parasympathetic nervous system is working really hard to recover from the training block. With this in mind, generally speaking, while each person's HRV is unique, higher values generally indicate better autonomic balance and adaptability. Factors that can increase your HRV include exercise, positive emotions, and certain dietary habits, where stress, negative emotions, alcohol, caffeine, and poor diet can decrease HRV. Unlike resting heart rate, where lower rates are typically healthier, HRV values are more individualized and trends over time are more informative than absolute values. Recently, many consumer wearable devices have come to rely on HRV to provide users with an idea of their readiness. Garmin, Oura, Whoop, and Fitbit all have some variation of a readiness score that is largely derived from HRV. The core technology behind these wearables is photoplethysmography, or PPG for short. The catch with PPG is that it only works well when you're completely still. Any movement can throw off readings significantly. Even doing something like typing or flexing a muscle in your wrist, and suddenly your HRV data is triple what it should be. That's why continuous monitoring with wrist-worn wearables can produce inaccurate data. They're prone to errors from everyday movements and physiological factors like ectopic beats, which are more common than you might think. When it comes to accuracy, chest straps are better. They measure the heart's electrical activity and are less sensitive to motion. But this raises the important difference between HRV and pulse rate variability, or PRV. HRV is all about the heart's beats, while PRV is what something like the Apple Watch or Oura Ring measure. It's concerned with pulse rate changes. This distinction is actually pretty complex, and we don't really have the time to get into it, but even things like your blood pressure can affect your PRV. This is one of the reasons why, if you're using a wearable device and therefore PPG to measure your heart rate variability, you're better off taking a measure in a very controlled setting, like first thing in the morning after you wake up, rather than throughout the day.
If you wanted to take a manual HRV measurement with your wearable device, you could follow these steps. Once you wake up, if you need to, visit the bathroom first, then either in a lying or sitting position, measure your HRV for between 1 and 5 minutes. Remember, be consistent. If you're taking serial measures over days, weeks, or months, follow the same protocol. Don't change the time frame and don't lie down for some and sit for others. Some researchers even argue that taking a HRV measure sitting up is better because the orthostatic stressor it induces makes the data more sensitive, effectively capturing your body's stress response. You probably won't have a choice when it comes to the specific statistical method that your wearable device uses, but most measure HRV using time domain outcomes like ORM SSD.
When it comes to HRV, you need to recognize that normal is better. Stability is what you should be aiming for. This personal frame of reference allows you to compare daily measurements or your weekly baseline to understand when you're under more stress than usual. By focusing on relative changes over time rather than absolute values, you can better identify periods of higher or lower stress and adjust your lifestyle or training accordingly. For example, if your HRV today is lower than yesterday's, it might indicate increased stress, suggesting a need to limit additional stressors to avoid negative chronic responses like burnout or overtraining. A key principle of HRV-guided training is to limit stress on days when HRV is suppressed. This approach isn't about avoiding stress, but rather managing it more adeptly. A stable HRV indicates a positive response to high stress, suggesting well-developed fitness and the ability to recover quickly from intense stressors. Conversely, a dip in HRV signals a negative response, often due to a mismatch between the stressor and our current capacity to handle it. This could be either an overly challenging stimulus or the impact of non-training related stressors like lifestyle changes or psychological stress.
To analyze HRV stability, we can use the coefficient of variation, which measures day-to-day variability in HRV scores. This measure differs from the baseline, which is an average of your scores over a past period. For example, if your baseline HRV is 60 milliseconds and your daily scores are consistently around this number, your coefficient of variation will be small, indicating stability. However, if your daily scores fluctuate widely, the coefficient of variation will be large, suggesting less stability. This variability, combined with baseline changes, can offer insights to how well you adapt to training and other stressors.